There have been many, and I sort of understand the relationship between Exile and Guyville, your album, and Exile and Main Street, but I don't understand it at all, and I'm glad you're here to sort of explain it.
Well, that's okay, because it would be difficult for you to understand it. It's something that was very, I took it like a thesis. So I was just thinking the other day that I would go to my parents' attic and dig out all the papers that I had, the lists and lists, to try and make sense of it so I could be more clear in explaining this. What I did was I just took the Exile on Main Street album, like lyrically and just in terms of like arrangement,
sequencing,
and I answered it in my own way. Sometimes it was disagreement. I treated mixed lyrics as sort of my love object. You know, he was what the man was saying, and this is what I was coming back with. And it was just kind of like this little dance between the two albums, which it wasn't literally, well, this is my version, or this is the same thing only from a female point of view. I was talking, it was a dialogue between their...
So it was a response record? They called it a...
Completely. I had all the songs. I didn't write any of the songs for that conceptual device, but I didn't know how to make an album. I mean, here I had this thing with Matador, and I had to come up with an album. I had no clue which songs. I knew which I liked, but I had no idea what anyone else would like, and I had no idea how to arrange them in an order, you know, how to sort of put it together in a listenable, long form. So I just...
There are two things that are really funny about that. How did you understand... That is, like, my second favorite album of all time. I can never understand the lyrics to it, ever.
You have to listen to it a lot. I had it in a Walkman for months.
But even like, what does he say in the beginning of Tumble and Dice? I mean, Linda Ronstadt did a cover of that song, and she got it wrong.
God, you have to play it for me again. Well, okay, let's just say I inferred where I could.
Okay.
I basically listened to phonetics and put it together. You can get enough. If you listen hard enough, you can get enough out of the lyrics to figure out what
right.
they're talking about, basically.
Right.
You're probably missing a bunch of the lines, but more than not, I just worked with what I had, and I didn't set any rules for myself. It didn't have to be strict assignment. It was just a way to, you know, pull it together for my own album.
I feel much better now. It all sort of is now clear to me. I guess
clouds have parted.
I guess we're gonna play Never Said right now, the hit single and video from
the
album. More wardrobe changes in this than the Diana Ross.
We had fun with that. There was going to be even more. We cut it down. That wasn't edited.
This is the most poppy song on the record. This really sort of stands out as the ultimate, like, hook, chorus, verse, you know, that whole thing.
Yeah,
sort of,
we meant it to.
Did you?
Yeah, definitely.
We'll talk more about that later. Here it is. It is Never Said from Exile and Guyville. Moomin, if there is such a thing.
But more like the poster child for the cultural famine in the Midwest. It's alive! It's alive!
But there's definitely, like last year, since I live in New York, the Village Voice article with PJ Harvey on the cover, and you were the Village Voice Album of the Year.
Album of the Year.
And they took, you know, The Breeders and Hole. Is that even an issue for you, or do you...
I don't think about it that much. I really don't. I don't think that it... That was mostly a decision a long time ago when I would read my press, and it would just... I was developing this enormous superego, you know, like a panel of critics and judges sitting over my shoulder, which made it almost impossible to really write anything new or, you know, write a song that wasn't industry-based, you know, like, oh, it's so hard to be here, you know, and so I just stopped. I think I feel it most when I come in contact with people that are so aware of it. And they freak out on me. They get that flush in their face and their eyes are popping out. They're like, what's it like? What's it like? You know? And that's funny. That's ironic.
You must get pretty intense. I would imagine you get pretty intense fan mail.
Don't read it much. Yeah, I have to write my grandmother's before I start writing fans.
But do you read it though?
Sometimes I do. If it gets to me, I always read it. And I just kind of keep a stack of it, and when I start reading through it.
If I was a 17-year-old girl, I mean, I would be like, oh my God, you said everything that I wanted to say and, you know, couldn't say it. You would just be like it for me. And I would imagine you have sort of that, or maybe.
That happens to me in like donut shops or something. People would come up and this one girl, I remember, she couldn't even speak to me. She was like shaking. You know, you just want to be like
the girl
I'm
the Oscars.
I'm you, you know, it's the same thing. That division between celebrity and human is so, that's funny. We create that and then we bitch about it.
Yeah, I know.
Welcome to America.
Stick around for more conversation with Liz and a live performance from her and her band as 120 Minutes continues. Great, they seem like musician-wise.
Yeah, they are great. It evolved from the album. We recorded the album and then basically I needed a live act.
Should we talk about real quickly like this sort of the story of how like the album like came about or how you got signed?
How I got
signed.
Is
that a boring story or is that?
That's boring and long, but I can make it really fast and try and spice it up.
Okay.
I've been playing guitar and writing songs for much too long considering my lack of technical skill at this point, but I didn't let on to anyone that I played or wrote songs or anything. My parents didn't even hear it. Finally, I was living in San Francisco after graduating from college, and a friend of mine, he's sort of notable, Chris Brokaw, he's in Come, and it was in Codeine. He came to visit us, and he talked me into it. I felt so low about what we hadn't done that semester and all of our big plans for, like, theater productions, film. He said, just make me some tapes, you know, just make me a couple tapes. So I just made him a tape, and I sent it to him, and I sent it to Taewon Yu, and they started making dubs of this. It was under the name Girly Sound, and that just sort of spread through that underground tape channel. It's just this amazing little almost like sub-postal system.
Yeah.
And then Gerard had heard of it by the time I called him, and I called him because I asked Brad, I'm really sick of my situation. I said, who's the coolest indie? You know, who would I like shoot for? He said, oh, Matador. So I called Gerard and he'd heard of me.
Who's the owner of Matador?
Owner of Matador. He'd heard of me through these tapes. And so it was really simple and easy. He said, great, make us a record.
And then how did the band come together?
Brad owns the studio. He runs the studio Idful where I recorded it. And I'd been recording with him with another friend of mine, John Henderson. We were supposed to put out an album, but then we disagreed on how it would sound. And so Casey worked for Brad as an engineer at the studio. And so Brad was playing the bass and the drums, and Casey came in with a couple leads because I was doing a Stones tune. And I just said, Case, you know, I need you. And Casey's a very Stones-esque lead guitar player. Yeah.
Do you ever feel overwhelmed by them or sort of like, oh God, thank God they're here to sort of make up for?
I think thank God they're here because in no way do I ever feel, and we worked that out, they've been great through a long period of time, getting me to trust them, getting me to feel like I wasn't ever, my main fear with the band is that I would be submerged by my band, that it would turn into this thing. I watched bands form and dissolve over a number of years. I never, ever, ever wanted to be a band. That was like the last thing, or go on the road. That was my, you know, clear distinction between, like, say, my art history major and like what I could have done with this hobby of mine. And it was just this very clear distinction. Do not want to be a band. So now I have a band that mainly is comprised of the people I record with, and then we take it live, and we do our best, considering that it isn't a band, and we, you know, we work together, they make me feel comfortable, I'm in charge, I don't ever get submerged, I write the songs, they are recorded according to my needs, then they get to play their own parts, I don't tell them what to do, you know, in that sense. Yeah. And so it's like, really worked out well.
Beautiful relationship.
Yeah.
We'll be talking more with Liz, and you'll see that very band that we're talking about in just a little bit. But right now, a brand new video from the Scottish band One Dove, and right now a brief pro.
Major tour, we don't tour majorly.
Have you gotten comfortable with the idea of playing live? Have you feel pretty good about that now?
I'm not nervous anymore. We've still got a ways to go. And I think, I vacillate between thinking that it's a really good idea for me to pursue this, and then sometimes I think, oh, what am I doing here? Why am I doing this? You know, I didn't originate as a band. I didn't originate as a performer. I would consider myself a writer or a recorder or an artist, but I wouldn't consider myself a performer. And I think there is a distinction. So that's always sort of an issue with me.
So, do you like move around more these days, or do you sort of just like hold up?
I think my hips kind of like shift back and forth, maybe a little bit more. Brad says I'm working on it. Sometimes my foot taps. That I've started to introduce it. I think I'm doing it so I can prove that I can play guitar at some level.
Well, you do okay at it, I think. But you're a great songwriter though. Can I ask you about the album cover?
Sure.
Does it, do you ever get like, it sort of looks, you sort of look like Stevie Nicks on the cover.
Yeah, that was so funny. That was when we were picking that one. I was at the Rainbow and I was doing these photo booth photos trying to make an animated sequence, which is really difficult because there's a good 20-second pause between each photo. So you're like... I was trying to mouth the words, you know, like slow pronunciation of syllables. And I came out with these, and Nate from Urge Overkill was with us, and he just grabbed hold of this one, and he said, Lizzie, this is it. Look at this, crop it right here. It's fantastic, look at this. And he like basically just convinced me that this was the album cover. It was the new, and he said that. He was like, it's the 90s Stevie Nicks, it's fantastic, it's brilliant. And I submitted an earlier cover to Matador with tons of collaged photos and stuff, and I think Chris is just like, no one's gonna buy it, no one wants to look at this woman in a pool. She's like this fat woman in a pool. And so we threw in this one, and...
Well, I'm sad that we have such a short time, because one thing we didn't talk about is that your album is done. It's in the can, I guess it'll be...
That's okay, we'll have plenty of time to talk about that.
Okay, and you come back and play live for us in a little bit, okay? Stick around, because we're at
Thanks
break.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you for coming. Liz Phair and her band will be back performing live, so stay with
Liz Phair and her band, 6 feet one.
Instead of 5 feet 2, and I love my.